star-studded tournament, as we are going to get into our first game of the group as a whole very, very soon. It is going to be Zest going up against Nerchio. These two players, storied from time and time again, Zest, a previous Intel Extreme Masters Katowice champion, and Nerchio, one of the hopefuls of the non-Korean scene, gentlemen. Where do we even begin?
I think this is a very important match, clearly, because he will set up the pace for both players going to this group. We saw that yesterday, you know, one map can make a difference at the end of the day. One single map, so very important to win here and open up with a little bit of a statement going into this group. Stylistically, I would say Zest has been very impressive against Zerg. We saw him in Nation Wars with some old-school Mass Stalkers, Sentries, Pushes and stuff. But Nerchio, supposedly, I do think that his style matches up well against Zest. Yeah. And I said that with in mind the fact that Zest might actually crush him, but I don't think so. I think that Nerchio has a very real chance here of doing very well with how good he is against Protoss, how good he is with Lurkers in particular. If he gets to that stage of the game, I'm not sure Zest is going to have really the experience against that style to do as well.
Yeah, this is a dangerous one to talk about because, you know, some part inside of me really wants to go, this is going to be awesome, I really have a lot of faith in Nerchio, but then obviously in the back of my mind, yes, I do watch all the online cups, and Nerchio hasn't been incredibly happy with this matchup as of late. He's been struggling. At the same time, a while ago, I would say 3-4 months, all the European Zerg said that when Zest was in Europe for Homestar Cup, for example, his PvZ was unbeatable. There was just no way they could break him. They all said that it couldn't be done. Zest was the best PvZ player in the world. So obviously having that in mind, you'd say like, well, Zest should be a favorite here, but I don't know. I mean, Zest obviously had a little bit of a rocky road getting here as well.
Nation Wars. There was a Zerg he lost to.
Ptuck.
Yeah.
World's greatest.
Oh, wow. I remember watching.
No, so it's a tough one, man. Like, I really do believe it's kind of 50-50, but if Zest just shows up here and he 2-0s Nerchio, then I can't be incredibly shocked either.
All right, gents, well, I'll check in with you in just a moment. For now, though, we're going to head over to the stage with Smix, who's ready for our first series.
Hello, guys, and welcome to the main stage here at the Intel Extreme Masters Katowice. It is time to welcome the players for our first match of the day. Our first player hails from South Korea. He is one of the best Protoss players in the world, a GSL champion. And of course, facing him is a player that needs no introduction. He is a Polish hometown favorite and a DreamHack champion. Get ready, it is Zest versus Nerchio!
Against Zest to try and find themselves footing here in Group C, a group rife with Protoss and Zerg. And as Todd mentioned, very important that they do set the pace. Now, what are we thinking here between these two? Because obviously, as you said before, a difficult matchup for Nerchio maybe going up against Zest.
Just when I thought Zest couldn't get any more handsome, did you see that slow-mo right there? more seriously, like I said, Zest, he likes his pushes. He can throw in some builds that are a little bit unusual with sentries and all that. Nerchio defensively, ever since Wings of Liberty, ever since the Daybreak times of Broodlord and Infestor, when Protosses used to throw Soul Trains at Zerg, like it was the only thing you could do, he was already very, very, very good in defense, getting enough roaches. And for the most part, I feel like it's very hard to hit him with timings early on and kill him. So I do think that he matches up well against Zest if he's able to survive the early on aggression, take it to the later stages of the game. And if he gets to play his Lurker style, I think that's going to be maybe the key for him to win in this series, or at least play to his image maybe even. Just go for a Lurker then, not use it, go for Muta, something like that.
It's funny because Nerchio has been pretty vocal about this matchup and the dislike, especially the carrier. And whenever they don't lose against the carrier, they lose because they were forced to make some sort of attack before the carrier was out. So, you know, the carrier is always responsible, right? Like, even when they're not being made, they're still the reason why the Zerg loses.
It's like that meme, the guy who falls off the bicycle.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
The carrier.
carriers. No, that's pretty much what it is. But I actually like Nerchio's ZVP. I really loved it when he was in WESG. He had that famous game against Neep. I casted that series.
Right.
Game 5 was one of the best ZVPs I've ever seen him play. He did everything right, except for the final fight, and then he still lost, which was really sad. That shouldn't have happened. But when he goes for stuff like Hydra drops or like 2 Lurkers and 6 Hydras, I love that, man. And I would love to see him bring it out. This crowd will go nuts if he plays the style like that.
Yeah, definitely. Traditionally, though, Nerchio, back when I was very, you know, more predominant in the StarCraft scene, I'm going to say.
You had passion!
Nerchio always used to have a bit of a harder time against the earlier aggression against Protoss. Has that been fixed now? Is that something that he doesn't have to worry about as much here against Zest? What do you think?
No, yeah, I feel like for the most part, he's been a good job of defending those early on attacks. Like, sure, there were always a couple Protosses that were like anomalies, like Stardust, you know, that somehow made like a 7 gate look like the best thing ever against Zergs.
Right, right.
And beat like some of the best Zergs in the world with it, including Nerchio at times. But other than that, I really feel like Nerchio should be sound, especially like if he knows that there is a chance he's going to come. And Zest has been known for this kind of style.
All right. Well, thank you very much, gents. We're about to get into our first series of the day. Of course, at the same time, we do have True versus Pili Pili and Several versus Patience, as we'll check in these breaks for now. But we are going to head over to the caster's desk as we bring you Zest versus Nerchio, game number one.
What's up, guys? We are about to go into game number one, Nerchio versus Zest. I'm Tasis, joined with Maynard. And dude, I am hyped for this match.
Dude, we have got one of the best Protosses in the entire world against one of the best foreigners in the history of the game.
Yeah.
It's about as good as it gets. And they both are incredibly good at this matchup as well. I'm expecting a blockbuster.
Yeah, I think it's going to be really awesome. Look, I think a lot of people might say that Zest is the favorite, but I think Nerchio absolutely can win here.
I actually disagree. I'm going to have to disagree with my co-caster, Tasteless, over here. I'm going to have to say that I think Nerchio takes this one.
Yeah, you know what? If he takes it, I would not be surprised. I don't think Zest is doing as well as we're used to him playing in the past few years. So this is an event that I think Nerchio could take. Also, this event uniquely different from the other StarCraft II events that Zest may be more familiar with. This is a marathon of a tournament. We started out with 76 players. By the end, we're only going to have one remaining.
That's right. And let's stop with the players. All of you guys in the crowd, start to warm up your vocal cords for this boy! This is your Onyx, Nerchio! There they are.
And his opponent in the upper right in the blue, from South Korea, he is Zest!
One of the most beautiful men in and out the game.
This is true. He definitely is not just good at StarCraft, he's good at being very handsome as well, Maynard.
Yeah.
In this match coming up here, I'm curious to see how Zest is going to play. Nerchio is a Zerg that isn't somebody who watches the Koreans and copies what they do. He's somebody who has his own way of playing the game, his own strategies that he's coming up with that are a lot of times completely changing the European meta. And I'm wondering how Zest is going to handle that.
I actually agree with you a little bit there. I think that the Europeans, especially like the Zergs, have a certain style of playing the game. And it's been that case since way back in the Heart of the Swarm as well, where the European Zergs kind of had a meta that was a lot different to how the Korean Zergs prefer to play. And it's definitely a style that's gotten success. I mean, the biggest case is Need going to Kesper Cup with a style that the Koreans were not prepared for, and then they absolutely crumbled in Kesper Cup.
And we're in an interesting period in StarCraft II history because the lines of Korean skill and non-Korean skill, I believe, are beginning to blur. We already seen Scarlet bring out some amazing games in the GSL. We saw Neeb kick some serious ass in Korea not long ago. And it's not that the Koreans have gotten worse, it's that the non-Koreans have gotten better. And with Nerchio's unique play style coming into this match, I'm curious if it could throw Zest off.
Well, speaking of uniqueness, there's a lack of that for Zest here. This is looking like the pretty standard kind of Archon drop transition. You know, you get the Darkshrine out, you get a Robo, that sort of thing, and then you get those you know, you get those Archons harassing, which is a style that Zest really, really, really loved here, and it definitely looks like that is going to be the case. And Nerchio, he's getting his Lings, he's getting speed, and also an Evo Chamber. So there's a couple things this could be.
Yeah.
It could be Overlord drop play, which is okay on this map.
I'm or he
could be going for upgraded Lings as well, which is another style that's really, really cool. So it's actually my favorite thing in the whole world, but it is going to be Dropper Lords there.
All right, so he's going to try to set up a drop. Now, this is all going to come down to how ready Zest is, but also how well Zest's control is versus Nerchio, because whenever Protoss do an expand build like this, they are limited on defense. That's why the wall-ins are just so important.
Now, the other, this might be Nerchio really playing to the opponent here, playing the man instead of the game, because he knows that Zest loves this style. He's been doing it for a very, very long time, and he knows that you don't have many units in your base. The Observer showed us he only has one Adept. That's his entire army right here and 34 probes. So he's powering very hard to get up to the next level of play, and Nurtio's going to capitalize by attacking early.
We see the Overlords now moving in. The double drop is about to commence.
Oh,
a Warp Prism on the way here.
That's right, Lings dropping into the main. And we are seeing the Lings getting the damage done. The probes are falling apart. They're just dying to the Ling drop here of Nerchio.
And we see the drops now coming in here. He's already lost power. The probes taking damage. Nerchio might not be able to recover. Probes continue to retreat. As he has so many buildings on power, I don't know what he's going to be able to do.
13 probes already dead. Nerchio is tearing apart the economy of Zest, which is still quite decent. He's got 23 workers still alive. He can recover from here, but he needs to get rid of these Lings. He needs to do counter damage.
The Lings now coming in here first around, hitting the Adept. The one Adept may go down. No, the probes managed to get in front. Lings now headed over here, back into the main. So much mining time lost. I think Zest is going to have to do a lot of damage with a counter here,
yeah.
But it may be too late.
It may be. A lot of probe damage has happened here, but Zest still has a lifeline this game. I think he had his Warp Prism out. There it is, the Warp Prism heading across the map. And he's going to have to get some counter damage done. He does have a Dark Shrine. He can get DTs. Two getting warped in now. More probes dying in the back of the natural, though.
And with the two DTs now coming in, there is one Spore in place. The DTs are not going to have a difficult time against the Queens here. One Queen, is not taken down. The Queen over here at the bottom is finally assassinated. Now two Queens have been taken out. And Lings against DTs, unless they get a good surround, it's going to be super problematic.
This Spore-crawler is Nerchio's only detection at this point. Nearly kills the DTs, but a hot pickup there by Zest does keep them alive. And we're sitting in a situation where Nerchio's killed a ton of probes, but Zest, it's time for the Archon drop. One getting built here, and he's warping in some Zealots to help out as well instead of an extra double card Dark Templar.
So the Zest is going to have to do a lot of damage if he wants to try to balance this game out right now. It's Zest with 23 probes to the 40 drones here for Nerchio, but the Archons with his Zealots, it's a pretty good counter to the Lings.
Absolutely. This is an anti-Zergling force here, Tasteless, and it's anti-drone as well. Nerchio needs to pull up the line of the third hatchery here, and he is pulling the Queens forward to try and help out with the Lings, but again, this Archon is so scary. The Warp Prism with its long-range pickup can keep that alive very easily. The Prism needs to be careful, though. If this goes down, Zest's lifeline, his counterattack to get damage, critical damage done against the Zerg is over.
Okay, another warp in comes in here. Right now, Zest scrambling to try to do any damage. Now, keep in mind, you could be very abusive with the Archons, picking them up in and out of that Warp Prism. So it's actually almost insane how much damage you can do. The moment the surround comes in, he immediately grabs it. And once the Archon comes out, the attack happens almost instantaneously. So it can take out so many of those Lings.
Another drop in the back here. Zest warping in a couple of these Adepts to shoo away the Lings. He's going into the main, though. Nothing in here. He can get another drop, a couple drone kills, a number of probe kills. If Zest doesn't micro correctly, he's losing probes here. And the Nerchio Lings are going back and forth. So Zest has done damage on the other side of the field here, but Nerchio is still with a very healthy worker lead, and his army's looking pretty decent as well as these Roaches come out. He has Lair now. Leal Reconstitution, Roach speed halfway done. Nerchio is going to have a very scary force soon.
And I got to say, I think that the counter drop to the Protoss's drop was a very smart move, because Zest had to invest so much into that attack in order for him to do any kind of damage to the Zerg, but that means he didn't have anything back home to defend. Now, Zest is still doing this harass, but it doesn't matter. GG! Nicely done! Game one goes to Nerchio!
Well played by the Polish Zerg. I kind of felt like this would happen a little bit, Tasteless.
You were right.
I kind of felt like this was going to happen, Taysom. I mean, the series isn't over yet.
It's
I don't want to say I told
look,
you so.
This is a really good start. And you know what? Zest didn't really get to practice against that style of play that we saw back there, which was so effective. You know, in the past for Nerchio, he usually has a lot of crazy stuff he's done with Nidus's and all sorts of crazy late game stuff. But yeah, in game number two, if Nerchio does go for a standard game, it's not going to be something Zest at least got to warm up to.
So guys, we're just going to take a quick break before we get into game number two. We'll just head over to the guys at the desk and see what's happening in the other games before we start it.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. Wow, what a start for Nerchio right out of the gates here. 1-0 up against Zest. Let's check in with the boys here at the desk, though, as we do have two games currently going on. At the moment, we have Serral versus Patience going on. Todd, let's check in with you first.
Yeah, game one on Belcher Vestige. Patience somehow kept Serral low on tech, and even though Serral was able to expand a lot, so did Patience. Serral played a very stale kind of game. You know, he's the guy who loves to go into Hive, who's very good with it, but he was just stuck on Lair for a too long time. Not much really happened in his favor. Like, he made a couple of mutas, did some damage. So now, he ended up just being picked apart because his bases, you know, they're very spread out on Belcher Vestige. Now we're in game number two, and not really much has happened just yet. You know, it's just kind of a standard game, I would say. Like, kind of like in the previous game, Serral's going for a Spire, but this time around, he's actually skipping other tech. Last game, he got a lot of tech buildings, Hydralis, then Spire, and then when he reaches Lair, when those buildings are finally finished, that's when he decides what he goes into, whereas in this game, it looks more like he wants to go into a lot of Links and then maybe Mutas to complement them to try and beat Patience this time.
All right, thank you very much. Well, checking in now with Rotterdam, who is in True versus Pilly Pilly, and at the moment, 1-1.
Yep, game number three is on the way on Cactus Valley, but we just started. We're 1 minute in, so there really isn't anything to show. The series is what you expect of two teammates going up against each other. It's messy, it's scrappy, it's random builds, it's let's make a lot of units on moments where we don't expect. Game number one, Pilly just played excellent. He defended everything at home. He pushed with Immortals and Sentries on the other side of the map, and he won. That push lasted for like 9 minutes, by the way, because two kept attacking on the other side of the map. Yeah. It was a funny game on Belcher, but Pilly won. Game number two, True actually did something that I've been talking about a lot lately. It's when Protoss opens up with Resonating Glaives and your 3 gate is already and you're ready to shade out. Right when you shade out, that's when Zerg players should drop the 8 links, because then your gateways are on cooldown and you've got nothing. It's the most annoying thing in the world. True did it, immediately killed 10 probes, and Pilly felt forced to go for a 2 base all in after that. He just didn't have enough.
So obviously what we had on the main stage here, Nerchio and Zest. Nerchio taking the first game in quite quick fashion. There's something going on, Todd, in laptop number two.
Yeah, can we check out this game here? Because Patience, he's up to his old tricks here. He's doing a big push with Sentries, Immortals, and Stalkers. Can we have a look here, please, on laptop two? Yeah, he's pushing forward, and without a Mothership Core, that means no recall. And I think Serral did a good job of getting ready for this with a ton of Banelings, Zerglings, and Ravagers. He actually completely skipped Mutas to try and properly counter this. And it looks like Protoss players are about to close their eyes around the world right now, because these sentries are out of energy.
The Banelings just aren't dying. They're going to get through.
Take it away.
No.
to go back to Nerchio against Zest, there's only one way I could summon that game up.
Uh-huh.
Zest, welcome to Europe. You know, going up to 46 probes. Well, he didn't have 46 probes, but he had like 36 probes. Having one adept, no Mothership Core whatsoever. It's like, that doesn't work, man. These boys will link drop you. You're going to need to get a Mothership Core and at least an adept or two before you want to go up to DT drop.
And it seems like Serral was victorious in that game just then. So thank you very much, gents. We'll check in with you in just a moment. For now, though, we're going to go over to game number two here between Nerchio and Zest.
I'm excited to go into this game number two.
Oh, yeah.
I think Nerchio starting out today with a lot of momentum, home turf advantage. He beat Zest in game one handedly. And when you're playing like that and you have all these people obviously rooting for you, he's Polish, he's in Poland.
He is, yeah. That is true, Chase.
You got to be thinking he's going to be riding those waves of euphoria going into this next match.
And he said in his interview with Smix, if you guys have been watching from home when we'd, over at the ESL studios, we actually heard from Nerchio that he really, really wanted this crowd. He wanted his Polish fans out there to make noise for him and to really cheer it on, because it does actually help him a lot. So if you're a fan of this kid and we get in a game, you know what to do. Katowice in the top left here from Eurotix Gaming. This is Nerchio.
Thank you.
and his opponent down one game so far in the bottom right, in the blue, from South Korea, he is Zest!
It's the face of a cold-blooded killer right there. But like Ruddy said, welcome to Europe.
Welcome there to Europe.
To Europe.
That's right.
There is a new meta here. Well, it's actually not a new meta. There is a different meta here that he doesn't ladder against every single day.
So
everyone's livening up out there in the
right,
auditorium.
Guys.
Oh yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
So going into this game, this is a lot of pressure for Zest here. You know, I think he was super greedy in game
one.
That's okay, because that's why it's a best of three, is if you do take a risk, you can still try to alter your style of play and maybe recover and come back the next two games. But I think that Nerchio's late game style is not only so different, but also so strong that Zest may have a problem there as well.
Yeah, and I'm actually really excited. I'm a little bit wiggly and jiggly trying to think about what could be the options here. There are so many. Cactus Valley is a huge map. Long rush distance, multiple spawn locations. One of the few four-player maps, I guess, along with Honor Grounds in the current ladder map pool. So there's a lot of options and a lot of tricky business that can happen here as well. That is a Scantipede.
That is a Scantipede.
Well spotted.
I wonder, as we go into this, how well a lot of our Korean players are going to be doing.
Well,
so
far
these games are so these days are so long, which a lot of them are not used to. You know, the esports setup. For StarCraft II in Korea is one where you practice for, you know, a burst match, basically. You have like a week to prepare against one opponent, try to fine-tune all your builds. At the Intel Extreme Masters, it's a different beast. It's a marathon.
It is, yeah.
And you are playing games for an entire week if, you're, if you manage to stay alive that long. And I do wonder if we're going to see a difference in how Nerchio sizes up to Zest by the time we're done with this group.
Well, so far, no difference for Zest. And this is kind of a Zest-ism. He's very much comfortable with this build. He loves it. It's very, very good, and it is very strong against a lot of things, except for what Nerchio chosen. Luckily for Zest, Nerchio is going to give him a chance to start, you know, start the drop play. You can't really do a ton on three hatcheries here. He is going to expand instead of, you know, going for the fast Eva Chamber drop a lord tactic that he did in game one. This map's a lot bigger than the last map, so
right.
it's a little bit more awkward. And there's the glaives coming out here for Zest. So the going to see some more gateways soon. Robo probably. There it is.
There it is.
And. And we're going to see Adepts, we're going to see Dark Templar, Tasteless, and some Cotton Ball Archons.
Yes, I think we will. So he's going to try to muster up enough Adepts. And the thing with Adepts, and what makes them so scary when you have somebody as good as Zest controlling them, is that you can constantly reposition and juke and jive. Mm. And to be honest, the Adepts, I think, looks like, oh my god, it got away. Nice escape there. The Adepts, when they first came out in Legacy, it was really interesting because nobody quite could figure out how to use them correctly. And then once people got pretty good at it, nobody could stop them. And then eventually everything started to balance out as people got the hang of it, because there was no unit in RTS that really quite operated this way. But yeah, he's going to try to put a lot of pressure on there with those Adepts, possibly going into a drop here as well when those glaives finish.
This may just actually be Prism Mass Adept here. I stand corrected, because we do see that, you know, the gateway's going down. We haven't seen a Dark Shrine yet. And Resonating Glaives, you don't always see that when Protoss are going for the drop Archon strategy with the Warp Prism. So this could just be a ton of Adepts, but we'll have to see how many gateways he drops. Nerchio is still sitting on three bases. Lair halfway done. Roach Warren also halfway done. And his drones are looking pretty healthy at the moment. Nearly up 50.
Note that Nerchio is checking every corner to see which way the Warp Prism will come out. That's why those Lings are there. And then the Overlord just to the right of that. He's trying to get a good read on this. We have a third base coming out. So this may not be a big rush, but actually an Adept pressure build, where you're forcing the Zerg to have to respect the presence of the Adepts. While the Protoss takes the third base, and then the setup for later on will probably be to try to smash Zerg on a fourth base.
Mm. And I'm happy to see Zest pulling out something a little bit different here, because, with the Immortal here, I love this from Zest. So the Immortal, obviously a fantastic anti-armor unit. It'll decimate spine crawlers, static defense, hatcheries, queens, roaches. And roaches are on the way here for Nerchio. So,
unaware. Here we go. The four Adepts coming in, gunning down a few of these drones. As the drones attempt to evacuate, he tries to fire at the queen. The Lynx coming here for a surround. He will most likely have to pick up, and he does just that.
Gets three drones here for just a bit of shield damage on those Adepts. Definitely worth it. That's free damage there for Zest. And Nerchio is getting his Overseers out. He's getting detection because he knows that, you know, Dark Templar still could be a threat. Hydralis Den on the way as well. Fantastic anti-gateway countermeasure. And there's those gateways. So the Adept, the mass Adept attack is imminent here as these finish.
We have the gateway explosion inbound here as the third Nexus has completed. It's now going to be a struggle here for the Zerg to try to get a fourth base. In StarCraft Fundamentals, we generally expect the Zerg to be one base ahead of the Terran or the Protoss, for that matter. But on a lot of these maps, the fourth base can be tricky. This map, it's not as bad, I would say, but on some maps, it's tricky. But regardless, somebody like Zest knows how to put pressure on. He's faced tons of good Zergs before.
Oh man, this is actually a very, very scary army against what Nerchio's got here. That's a ton of force fields in these sentries, one apiece at least. Looks like a couple of them are going to have multiple force fields as well, and Nerchio scrambling a defense. Zest knock it on the front door with a good handful of Adepts and an Immortal at the back. Getting rid of that Immortal is very important. Getting rid of the Prism, also very important for Nerchio, but no Ravages just yet. He's coming forward. There's a couple of Ravages on the right. Nerchio getting a nice corrosive pile on the sentries here, but most of the natural of Nerchio has been denied by these force fields.
He's got the force fields blocking out the Roaches and the drones. He's going to dive in on top of the third base. The Ravagers are being pulled away. The force fields have not expired just yet, so he can't come in here for a shot, but the Lick's now coming in the back and hitting the sentries.
The sentries getting hit by big Biles there. A little bit of miscontrol by Zest, but he's already done a ton of damage. Nerchio didn't seem like he was ready for this. He's scrambling. He's actually,
he shot down his own overseer.
There's a little bit of misfire on both sides, but is it a game of numbers at this point? The hatchery is so low. More Biles connecting with the Protoss army. Zest doesn't even care. Bile my army, whatever, man. I just have way too much. Warping in more here. No Biles hitting that warp prism. The Adept being reinforced.
And with this amount of units, it looks like he's going to go for the kill move here, trying to shade these Adept forward to possibly come on top of that army. And there it is.
Oh.
He's going to try to kill the Ravagers.
And he will, Tasteless. This is too much Protoss on the dance floor. The Zerg is trying to get things done, but he is bleeding units. 61 army supply to 26, and he's lost a lot of drones as well. What can Nerchio do?
GG! It's tied up 1-1 as Zest wins game number two.
We've got ourselves a series, Tasteless.
Right.
Gonna go to map three here at Katowice at Spodek Arena. A lot of smiling faces out there, a crowd. Maybe a couple bit of frowning faces out there because Nerchio just lost a map.
That's right, but Nerchio can still come back.
Oh,
he just has to win this next game, but Zest really flexing his muscle in the mid game, going into the late game, if it would have gotten that far, in his Protoss versus Zerg. Let's go ahead and go to the analysis desk and see how the other matches are going. Claris, take it away.
Thank you very much. We're just about to get the final moments of True versus Pili Pili by the looks of things. So we can jump into laptop one because that's almost about to end Rotterdam here.
Yep, it is. And not for the reason why many people might think it ends. Let's take a look at my screen real quick because I want to show you guys. Most people say, like, of course it's almost about to end. We see carrier, fleet beacon. Let's take a look, James. It's like, okay, hatchery. It's carriers against hatchery tech.
What?
So yes, this is about to end. Pili just did a phenomenal job. Resonating glaives, three gate, followed up, double stargate, plus one air weapons. I love this build. It's absolutely my favorite build in the world. True tried to Baneling bust him, but there was one clutch moment where the Phoenixes over here, they took a little flight path, they found the Banelings, they lifted them. He barely survived, he lost the Nexus, but True had no economy, True had no tech, and eventually these Phoenixes, they just started to wreak havoc. I mean, look at the amount of Overlords that died, 18, 40 drones went down, and True, in typical True fashion, made nothing but links, and now he's still on hatchery tech against carrier. So even though this game is still live, it's safe to say that the GG moment is upon us.
I like how his answer is just make as many queens as possible and hope.
Yeah.
Like, that's the only thing he has available to him at this point. Oh well, looks like Pili Pili very much so in the driving seat looking for a 2-1 there against True. Thank you very much, Rotterdam. Next up, of course, we do have Todd, who's with Serral and Patience at the moment, and I think it's 1-1 at the moment.
Yeah, it's 1-1 in the third game. Both players sitting back a lot more than what we saw Patience do in the previous game because he didn't really walk out. So Patience happy to just kind of sit back, take it slow. We can have a look at the situation. He's on four bases right now with this army against this army. So both players, I think they're pretty worried about overextending and going too far in attacking, but Serral might be gearing up for an attack, actually, because he's getting a ton of Banelings, and he
it's gonna, if he hits with this plus two there, he might be able to do really well, because like economy wise he's actually quite a bit ahead with 70 walkers to 57. So actually I think it's funny, I feel like Cyril might have wanted to attack, but because Patience has this army and he has force fields, he's confident also to maybe take a fight, but not really on creep. So it's there is so many times in this game where they're about to fight, but at the last second they're like, nah, actually, let's just wait for the next deck. Let's just do one more transition, and they end up not really fighting too much.
I have an update, by the way. Layer has started 15 minutes in.
That's your update. I love it. Well, yeah, that's going to go well. Hopefully, Pili Pili continues vengefully on, and it's going to do well. All right, well, thank you very much, gents. We'll check in with you in a moment. For now, though, we're going to head into game number three of Nerchio going up against Zest.
All right, we are moments away from starting game number three here. Zest definitely exhibiting a lot of strength in the mid game. He really put that pressure on Nerchio. Nerchio not even on a fourth base, but ended up getting run over by that adept push. The Immortal never picked off. You know, there's two parts to that rush. One is the Immortal, the other is the Warp Prism.
Yeah,
and
the
if
Immortal.
You get one of them, usually you can start to push him back, but if you don't, it's pretty strong.
Yeah, when that push was happening, like I mentioned, the Immortal was super critical there for Zest. If he lost that or the Prism, it would have been pretty much all over, because the reinforcements of the Zergs usually are going to be able to crash that in time. But let's get into it, guys, for game number three. Make some noise for your boy. If you want to see him win, this is Nerchio!
And his opponent here in the bottom left, in the blue, he is Zest!
All right. Now, Zest, I thought this was going to be a very quick and easy Nerchio series, I'll be honest, because this kid has been on fire. Zest been on a bit of a lull. But Zest, like, looked at me, he made eye contact, and he rolled up his sleeve, and he's like, do you see this definition, Maynard? This is my Protoss muscle right here. I've been flexing it. I've been practicing really, really hard. I am the best, one of the best Protosses in the whole world, and I am not going to go down easily here in Poland.
Yeah, it's going to be tough. It's going to be really tough for Nerchio here. Also, interestingly enough, we have in the center right here the hatchery being taken here. You know, obviously, if you watch any StarCraft, you're going to get usually a base at your natural because it's easier to defend. So I'm curious to see how Zest will react to this. Is there anything at his disposal he can use to try to punish Nerchio here?
Well, this is a shorter rush distance. You can be aggressive on this map. There's it's not too bad for drop play as well. And depending on where the Zerg expands, it can be pretty decent for the Protoss as well, depending on, you know, where that third hatchery is placed. And speaking of the third hatchery, it looks like the second hatchery is going down to the north location up here. So Zest maybe denied that natural a bit.
Yeah, it does appear to be the case here. We are going to see now what exactly is the strategy going to be from Zest. You know, he took that third base. It was actually a pretty well-rounded strat coming from Zest. You know, he took expo, got, you know, the gates up there, and then the pressure was just a little bit too much. And I have seen some games where I think Nerchio might overdrone a little bit, so he's going to have to be super cautious about that, because the complexity to forcing Zerg to make drones in PvZ especially is huge. There are so many tricks and techniques. Think when to move out with your army versus when to you know, come and not commit at all and back up just to keep them under droning is pretty big. And somebody like Zest is going to be trying to exploit that throughout this game. We're still waiting to see that third hatchery go down. Presumably it will be here at the Zerg's natural.
Yeah,
there it is.
Zest knows that he just expanded somewhere else, and he knows where he's expanded, because otherwise he would have walked through creep to go back home with this probe. The adept coming forward here. Now, you were speaking of, you know, taking advantages against the Zerg here, and I think that, you know, identifying the fact that this hatchery is all the way to the north here, that is very tough for Nerchio to defend with anything but Lings, because the Queens are never going to be able to get there to defend in time, and this single adept could actually get some damage done.
So he's going to try to get one drone kill. Oh, not actually timed out well. That was actually pretty good there. For Nerchio, albeit Zest's fault for not quite having that timed out correctly. So no drones taken out here. And I will say, when we went up to that base, I was surprised it was only two Lings and a Queen. So he's droning hard.
Oh yeah, absolutely. We can see that he is getting up to, in the 30s here with his workers, but Zest is as well. And he is again in the situation where he's powering up for the next stage of his plan, which is this time definitely going to be the Archon War Prism drop strat that he won for in game one that Nerchio punished him for. But we know that Nerchio is not going for a blind counter at this point. He's just playing a regular reactive ZVP right now, which obviously he's really incredible against, but this is just going to be playing the matchup instead of the man.
One thing to note about the Archon drops on this map is, for instance, the natural expansion for the Zerg. The minerals are tucked all the way at the far right. I'm curious to see if Zest can actually get his Warp Prism stuck in the far right side of the map, because you basically have to go through or around the Zerg's base to really start doing damage. Obviously, it's great if the Archon kills off some Lings, but you really want to be interrupting the Zerg's mining. That's the entire strategy against any Zerg player, is interrupt mining, deny drones, or get them, off tempo as far as economy management and army management.
Yeah, if you leave a Zerg alone, you're going to have a bad time. They'll spread out of control. They are very much like the species in the game.
Yeah, well, it's funny because that's the whole game. A lot of times Zergs don't have to do that much engaging until much later on. Oh, we see some Lings coming in here.
Sure.
All right, he goes for it. A nice denial there. Very important. Also, the probe zone back out and the Overlord dropping some creep.
Oh, that's
this
so
is
annoying.
Sick.
But Zest is coming in with these DTs now, and Nerchio has no spore in this natural. He's actually still, the
Overseer
is done. So there is this Overseer coming down here. Roach is coming forward as well. They're leading the charge here, waiting for that Overseer. There it is, and Zest's going to need to pick up these four DTs and save them.
He's coming through there right now. We see the Warp Prism now backing up. It's going over here towards the left. Meanwhile, though, the third base has been denied. It's going to be pretty tricky here for Zest. If he doesn't get a base up or do a ton of damage, oh, that's a funny way to solve that. I didn't really think of that. I guess that works too. If he doesn't get a third base up here soon, he may be forced into trying to do a lot of pressure on two bases, which doesn't have that much longevity if it doesn't kill the Zerg.
Well, until he gets Archons, he doesn't actually have any anti-air, so that pylon overcharge is the only way to
Okay. Pylon rushing overlords, man. I've seen it all now. No, that makes perfect sense with this tech. Yeah, he actually does not really have
the
sentries or the stalkers or anything else to get rid of it. Mm. And he needs the Archons to harass. Now, it seems like Nerchio's in a good position here, but he has to make sure to zone these Archons and more specifically the Warp Prism out.
Now you want to go for drones here, and there goes Zest, targeting the drone line of Nerchio. Needs to hit that economy. Nerchio is nearly at 60 drones, and he wants to slow him down. And he is going for a very, very good unit composition against what Zest has got going for him. So this is going to be a Blink Immortal follow-up, and Hydralisks can potentially become Lurkers, which are fantastic. And even just Hydralisks on their own, with Muscular Augments, which he is researching right now, that's Hydralisk speed, means that he can be as mobile as possible with a very, very heavy-hitting, high DPS unit.
So we have the third finishing, again, very late here. That little tactic by Nerchio paid out in dividends.
Yeah, very smart play.
We were talking about this earlier, but it seems that it's come true. You know, the Archon harass was nowhere near as devastating as it has been in some of the other games we've seen. And I wonder if this was the ideal strategy to use on a map like this, because the most of the other expansions, the minerals are hugging the right side of the map, so it's hard to get over there. So he got like a few drones, but it wasn't that tough for Nerchio to deny it.
This is a nice move by Zest, though, because he has the Observer with his Archons, and he's starting to kill creep again. So denying this creep makes it pretty tough. Like I said, this hatchery is pretty tough to defend if you don't have that creep spread. And Nerchio identifies that this is a weakness. He's dropping his creep tumors down to try and get the so that he can get between his bases as easily as possible. Because the Hydralisks, even with Muscular Augments, they are quicker, but they're not that quick.
He needs
to be on the scene when the Protoss army hits.
We see the hallucinated Phoenixes coming through once again, and just to try to scout and see what exactly is going on. Was that the Warp Prism that was gunned down? Oh, no, I'm sorry. That was the Observer that was gunned down.
Yeah.
So obviously that as well. You want to try to deny any scouting here so that you can actually push the Protoss and they might be out of position.
Yeah, and luckily for Zest, this Prism with the Archons is still alive. And not only can he continue to do harassment in this game, he can also get these Archons to join up with his main push, which isn't too far away here. As the Archons come back in the main, denying mining time. This is still damage, Tasteless. That's not mining. That's drones not mining here for a try and catch the Prism. Just missed it, though.
That was close. Not a bad attempt there. Denying mine is one thing. He did not kill that many workers, though. And as he pushes that out, he's going to have the Spire start here. So he's going to be going into an air tech, and this seems to be synced up with you know, the robotic support bay coming in here for the Protoss player. Keep in mind, after we have the very first big battle, we want to evaluate how many robo units were killed off or how many stayed in the game, because a lot of times that's a good indicator of where the Protoss is going to be later on. Immortals, Observers, Colossi, they come out one by one. They increment out in the game. So we want to try to see, for the Protoss' sake, him keep that alive. But for Nerchio's sake, try to go in there and assassinate as many of those as possible and maybe snowball the game later on.
Yeah. Nerchio, speaking of snowballing, is trying to get into Tier 3 here. He has Infestation Pit on the way. Even just the Infestation Pit, if he wants to chill in Tier 2, is quite good. But getting Tier 3 feels like a little bit more solid because you can get those upgrades and keep up with the Protoss, who already has the disruptor, the Robotics Bay. And I was going to say, Protosses have been starting to get Colossus instead of Disruptors in this matchup because of how Hydralisk heavy it is. It's very, very good against Hydralisks. Yes, the Colossus has been nerfed in Legacy of Void, but it's still very effective. It's a consistent damage. You don't have to hit with like you do with a Disruptor. It's just easy splash damage from 9 range, and he is getting extended Thermal Lance to make sure that range happens.
All right, now we have this game continuing into the direction of potential Turtling or Hard Pushing here from Nerchio. And I'm wondering what the ideal area is that Zest can attack from. Because a lot of times when you have lurkers like this, it's really about trying to hit them at an angle where they can't optimize their damage. Hold up, he's coming through here now. And looks like he's poking in to try to check where the lurker spines are going to come from. A good Zerg player has to rotate these lurkers pretty quickly.
And he has four crawlers ready for that Observer as well. Looks like he has to force cancel on this hatchery. Nerchio's still on four bases, but Zest is on four bases as well. And Nerchio can't really do a whole lot about that except for a Ling Run by, because he needs to stay here and defend against this very scary army of Zest. Zest's army isn't as big as Nerchio's, but it's very heavy hitting with lots of splash damage.
So Nerchio really going for the late game here. Now, in theory, you could try to poke this with Colossi at a distance, but it's actually just hard to pull off. The combination of lurkers and spore crawlers out and the fragility of observers can be a real headache for the Protoss. So I'm not sure what his next step is going to be. We're going to find out. Looks like he's also going to be able to chase out this Warp Prism here.
Yeah, Zest is going to need to unload these Archons because as these Corruptors get up and count, he's going to be very, very careful about losing those two Archons. They're very, very gas heavy. And this Prism, obviously very important as well because that is his reinforcement tool. And actually, we've been seeing that the minerals of Zest is quite high here. And I love that he's getting Zealot Charge. He's ready to be able to switch over into Zealots if he needs them to pad out his army. And Zest is beginning this push here at the third hatchery, Tasteless.
We see the Corruptors coming in. A good blink up to the top, but he does not take out any of those Corruptors. He's slowly shaving away the Spore Crawlers. That'll expose the position of the Lurkers. It's a game of back and forth, a game of cat and mouse between trying to gun down the Observers and the Colossi trying to shoot down the Lurkers and the Spore Crawlers.
Zest getting all the tools he needs, but he needs time to get them. He's getting speed for the Observers. He's getting Size Storms and plus 3 attack, ready for his Gateway and Robotics units. Fleet Beacon on the way as well for the very, very late game, and he's getting a few of those Corruptors denying the hatchery again. Nerchio is in a soft contain here.
Now, keep in mind, as this game progresses forward, Nerchio still taking a base at the very north. This isn't, Protoss isn't going to be in a good position until he breaks this defensive line, and it looks like he's going for that right now.
He's moving right in, a big fungal there, and he's in the lurker range. The bile's connecting as well, and the damage of Nerchio actually shaves a lot of
Zest. Gets the Warp Prism!
Warp
Prism out, he cannot reinforce now, and this may force him to reposition.
Nerchio's army is shooting ahead in supply versus Zest. Zest took a big hit to his army there. The fungal and lurker combination was so sick, Tasteless.
I love that he managed to handle that so well. And you can see Zest has to hit the reset button. There's no point in him trying to stay out there around all those hatcheries and you can't warp in. It would be essentially foolish for him to try and hold his ground. So he's backing up. Meanwhile, because Nerchio had some mobility on the map here, he's trying to go in here for a counterattack, although it looks like this is going to end up getting boxed in here at the upper left.
Definitely, and he was a little bit late to respond here, so he's not going to be able to win this gauge against the Stalkers. I mean, they do have blinks, so he probably wouldn't have anyway, but Nerchio getting caught for a run by these Lings coming in to help out as well. But, you know, Zest's economy is quite nice. He's sitting up nearly at 70 workers, whereas Nerchio, he's down at 59, so the income is definitely in Zest's advantage, as is being shown here by the Observer.
I like that the moment that Zest backed up, Nerchio tried to set up counterattacks, because that's one of the strongest things that Zerg can do against a Protoss, is whenever you leave your base, suddenly Lings or Roaches and small numbers come in and start hitting your workers or your Nexus.
Yeah. Oh.
And I think the positioning here for Nerchio, again, is not bad at all. He could very well win this game.
Oh, baby. Neural Parasite on the way for Nerchio.
Oh,
and that gets
wow.
me so excited.
He's going to try to push this hatchery. There's no creep over here, so he has to rely on simply his army, not static defense. He's going to go for a poke up here at the top. Actually going to go and try to take out this hatchery at the north, and that will be destroyed. And a forced cancel there. Great play by Zest.
Absolutely. Even if these zealots go down, he's choke-holding the economy of Nerchio. He cannot let him expand. And he's been doing a great job of it so far, Zest. Is just soaring ahead in income, and he's using that to his advantage. Look at his bank. He could easily make whatever he wants out of those gateways.
This is the phase where the Zerg starts to bank up a lot of minerals, but more importantly, a lot of gas. And when they go through a big fight and the armies are traded off, they immediately remax out with all of that income.
And Nerchio's bank on the other side of the fence is not very good at all. This isn't where a Zerg wants to be. They need to have that power of a bank to be able to remax with what they need to counter what they're up against. Zest dropping a ton of cannons to keep his economy safe here as he powers into his tier 3 army, which is going to be the Tempest.
Now, I got to point this out because we may be going in this direction. Notice this map. There are no shared expansions. There's no ambiguous expansions that either player could take. It's pretty clear that all the remaining expansions on Nerchio's side of the map should inevitably go to Nerchio. All the expansions for Zest should inevitably go to Zest. In other words, Zest can never expand to Nerchio's side of the map. It may be a game of the last expansion getting denied, or whoever can stay on it the longest, or we could get in a situation where this map begins to mine out.
Nerchio going for a run by here with the Lings, but Zest's army is not far away to answer the call for defense. Lings coming in here into the natural, and they will get some probe kills. There's not much left for Zest to mine here except for gas, which is quite nice. You know, probe kills are quite good. Anytime you can get any damage done is always fantastic against a player of this caliber. You need every advantage you could possibly get. Zest moving up here for another denial, looking for that hatchery again.
Okay, now this is funny because the idea was good, but because there's no expansion up here, he could end up destroying all these stalkers. At the same time, though, I guess he can free up that supply of stalkers for something else since both these players are maxed out.
Exactly. Well, I was just about to say Tasteless, but he doesn't really need these stalkers anymore.
Yeah.
What he really needs is the tier 3 army. He needs the Tempest, the Psystorm, Archons, and he's getting Void Rays as well. In fact, these stalkers didn't trade too, but I mean, they are going to go down. And he does see that there are Broodlords, so that's why we're seeing Void Rays, and the Mama Ship is on the way.
Yep, we got a Mother Ship coming out here, guys. One problem I see for Nerchio coming in here is how on earth is he going to push the Protoss?
Well,
Broodlords, you can run around. There's a lot of abusive things you can do because Broodlords are not fast. If Broodlords were fast, this game would be broken because they'd be too strong. At the same time, we see Zest, he is setting up for the option to switch into a mass air army.
Yeah.
Maynard.
That's right.
Maynard.
Oh, Tasteless.
This is a good game. This is a good series, guys.
We're having a good time up
Life
here.
Is good.
Life is good. It's a good job. I mean, this game started on the ground, but it is going to end in the skies. We are switching over to full air tech for both players. Actually, Nerchio is getting a Bane Ling Nest here, and I actually wonder if this is for Bane Rain or something like that, like showering those Banelings down, because that would be sick play, and that's something creative that a player like Nerchio would definitely bust out. But Zest, he's all about the skies, man. He is getting all of the Stargates down. I think he's up to 6 now, and with the Mothership, they will be under the cloak. Yeah, the 6 Stargates. Goodness.
You know, another thing to keep in mind is that every battle from here on out, you want to evaluate what was lost, because even though it can be remade because they have so much money, there's not infinite money on this map. And,
no.
and sometimes a game where it looks like one player is doing really well, he might be expanding faster. For instance, in this game, Zest has taken more bases in the later part of the game than Nerchio did, but that might mean Nerchio mines out later and Zest ends up spending literally all of his options, and then Nerchio can engineer some kind of a technical win with the few remaining minerals and gas that he can get.
Yeah, and the Observer just showed us there that as far as tech-wise goes, Nerchio's army is more expensive, even if the supply doesn't show that. He's got a very, very high-tech army, lots of expensive units like the Broodlords. And Zest has this little army of immortals there. Is he looking for a hatchery denial or something?
What Zerg wants to do with these immortals, because he doesn't really need them, is ideally get rid of them, but he can also park them in an expansion and just try to take this out. Oh, that's cute.
Yeah, good old Neural Parasite. That's just funny.
You know, can we just take a moment and appreciate that? We don't really get to see that very often.
I was going to say, your job's not done. Come on. Got rid of that last immortal there. Zest going for a huge Void Ray count. I mean, the immortals aren't going. You know what? That was deliberate. He had to get rid of those immortals. Yeah. They're not as important anymore. He wants the air army. He needs to be able to deal with the Broodlords and the Corrupt account and the Infestation and the Infestor combo here. Do you guys remember Broodlord and Fester Tasteless? Do you remember that with fond memories?
I remember, but I've read it in the esports history books, Maynard. And I got to say,
I thought you wrote those books.
I casted those books. I got to say, man, we're getting into a very, very technical unit comp. So this is a cool dance that happens, especially in this matchup, when you get two players who have cemented their position on the map so well. You have it where you get one big tech, and then the next, what they have to do is they have to switch into a tech to counter that, and then the Zerg has to switch back into another tech, and it's crazy.
Now, you might be thinking, Nerchio, the counter to Mass Air isn't Ultralisk, but he just got rid of all those immortals. So he knows that this Ultralisk could actually do damage on the ground if he manages to slip past the Sentinet here of Zest. That said, though, Zest is covering his bases quite well in this game.
I'm curious to see how the Neural Parasite's going to go. Now, in case you're new to StarCraft II, do not panic. This is not a really bad play. He's actually trying to sacrifice probes because he has to free up supply. When the game gets this big, you're in a position where you actually need to start throwing away units and filling them in with other more important units.
I love that. Getting rid of the Oracle, because the Oracle is just going to tag Nerchio's army all game long, and it also makes these Tempests powerful because they can shoot further than they can see. And that base that just got killed, that was the only base that was not taken on this map, because we are in the super, super late game here.
Now, he did show his army there at the bottom, so we do have a counterattack over here at the top of the map. Looks like these legs are going to be headed northbound. I don't know how many cannons are there.
Cannons.
No, it's just not worth it. It's just not worth it.
Lots of spore crawlers here for Nerchio, and that's a good way to free up supply as well. Like, these are structures that can help him a lot against the huge air army that he knows is on the field, and he doesn't want to overextend here. He has to play this patiently and efficiently.
We have the push coming in now, and it looks like, I don't know if this is wise for Protoss to do. I'm not sure how either player can actually get in and dismantle the other one without a huge risk.
It is tough.
Again, let's keep our eyes peeled for how Neural Parasite plays a role. I want to see what he tries to snag here, and we might be seeing that now.
Oh, feedback there, killing an Infestor and a Storm going down as well. He's just shaving the Spore Crawlers, but that Ultralisk is getting in here, and like I said, there's not a whole lot to shred him apart.
We have the Neural Parasite being used. He is drawing a Tempest.
Grabbing a Tempest there to come into the nest for a quick kill.
Right now, you can see Nerchio trying to fish Zest's army into his side of the map, do as much damage as possible. And in this little game of cat and mouse, you want to be trying to kill the units that are very gas intensive.
Yes.
Because the gas intensive units are going to play the biggest role in finishing the game. So even though it might look like there's not that much happening, these little skirmishes they're having, where they're trying to take out, for instance, he's trying to get Infestors or maybe kill a Broodlord, in the same time, Zerg's trying to get rid of Templars, but ideally like these Tempests, for instance. And in the long run, it might end up paying off. It's not a common thing to get a PvZ that gets this far, guys. Normally, somebody's outmaneuvered the other, and the
Absolutely,
game's over.
Yeah.
So this is a real treat to cast.
Yeah, this is like a super mega old school ZVP here going to the mega late game. Now, Zest's army is more heavily upgraded than Nerchio. Nerchio's been not paying attention to his upgrades for a while here. He's just getting 2-2. He's getting 2-2 for the flying units, so this is going to make his army stronger in the air. But Zest's army already has +3 attack, so they are hitting very hard. And you can see the power of the Oracle Tempest combo here, taking pot shots at those Corruptors. They can't come down here to defend this hatchery, and it does go down.
Okay, he's going to push in
here. That's the Infestors.
He did, that's right. He did tag the Infestors, which makes him kind of useless for the time being, because as long as they can react in time
and vulnerable to Tempests.
Yeah, exactly. So there is one odd problem here for Nerchio, and this may cost him the game. This expansion at the very bottom that we keep seeing get poked into, that technically, in this kind of a game, is the hardest base for the Zerg to acquire. They got to get all the way up on the high ground. They have to push all their Shattuck defense up there. It's hard to get the creep up there. And Zest appears to be setting this game up to try to dry up Nerchio's resources and force him out that way.
Oh, the Infestus.
Oh, here we go!
Feedback's going down there. Ural Pass side and a Colossus to get the damage done, pulling them into the nest so that they can be gobbled up by the Zerg army, and they do go down. And that's a nice pick off there for Nerchio as he cuts into Zest's army, forcing him to use some of that bank to remake units that he needs. And Zest decides that he wants to start getting those Immortals back in again to help out against the ground army. The 14 Infestors. Wow.
Yeah, it's pretty wild, man. After that little fight there, we do see that Zerg's going to try to get this base down here just below the screen. There it is. Nerchio has to get this base up. If this game goes on for longer and longer and longer, he is going to lose this game. Nerchio has to acquire this and suck up the resources or else.
Or trade efficiently and let Zest mine out because Zest is so huge and overpower side, and he gets the mothership. That's exactly what he wants here. Taking that down, now Zest cannot hide under cloak anymore.
And without the mothership there, it's going to be, oh, I guess he gets an Archon as well. Look at that.
Oh, Banelings.
Now, because he got the mothership, I think that Nerchio now, in fact, can take this expansion because the mothership is the headache for the Zerg. It's hard to actually get those neural parasites off. It's hard to engage correctly. And a great dive in right there, taking out the Oracle. Did not get the Observer, and he's going to be able to shuffle some of these Spore Crawlers over here and defend this position.
That's right, and it looks like a DT harassment here at the top, but there is a Spore Crawler, and the drones are workers' arrest, getting rid of that DT. Only two of them going down, so perhaps a little bit of miscontrol from Zest. Not too sure, we just missed that. But the weird thing here about this base coming up in Nerchio is that it's Legacy of the Void. He's going to have minerals there and a lot of gas for a while, whereas Zest has had all these bases all game long.
This is what's funny about this.
We could be in a weird situation where, yes, the Protoss has these bases for longer, but he's going to mine out before the Zerg does.
Can we do a quick mineral check from our observer to see what bases actually... okay, so they're mining out here. Okay, so he's no minerals there. This one at the top... Oh, no, that's actually not as mineral rich as I thought. All right, can we go down? There we go.
Yeah, this is a nice healthy base here.
So he was pretty much... Now, can we go to the Protoss' side of the map here? Let's do a quick mineral check.
Yeah, it's getting
mined out. He's not even mining that much there.
He's out of gas there.
We can count that as is gone. And then at the bottom, I'm sorry, if we could just do the bottom one there. All right, so that's super rich.
Yes.
But Zest is mining pretty quickly here. Actually, I feel like Zest has more mineral patches available to him than Nerchio.
It does kind of look like that. You might be right.
That's funny, yeah. Oh, hold up. He's coming in right now.
Oh,
taking
boy.
These Tempests, and they are going to go down, and that is a lot of gas units destroyed basically for free.
Getting these Tempests is huge, Tasteless, but Zest has six Stargates. He can make six Tempests at a time, and that production is insane.
But you know what Nerchio says? He says, do it. Make the Tempests. I'm going to get him again for free. And it might, I mean, Zest has to do it, but this is kind of what Nerchio wants to have Zest do here.
And I think the reason why there are, you know, this many patches is that Nerchio's used a lot of his drones to turn into Spore Crawlers. He's not actually, his income is quite dismal at this point, actually. Hasn't made drones for a little bit. So look at the income difference here, Tasteless, on screen right now between Zest and Nerchio. The clock is ticking for both players. It is a finite amount of resources on the map. The game cannot go forever, but we are heading towards a point where both players are going to need to make a decision, and Zest is slow poking with his static defense.
Well, this is actually really smart. He's just going to make the most insane push in StarCraft II. He's going to cannon crawl up to where the creep is. And this is good because really the way that Zest is going to win this game is he has to deny this bottom base that Nerchio has freshly acquired.
Zest actually just shaved off a couple Void Rays there. Feels like he needs the supply for something else, and it is going to be a couple Oracles. There's a big Fungal and a nice Neural Parasite, but the Storm's bullying Nerchio away from finishing them off.
You know, it's tricky for the...
that poor Archon. I almost feel bad
this
for
it. This is how it ends. So, we don't see right now Zest trying to jump on top of that bottom base just yet. It looks like he's going to rotate up here. This game does begin to slow down to a crawl as every decision that they're making has to be done perfectly. We're almost to the 30-minute marker in this game. We do not normally get that far,
yeah,
especially on this map.
And Legacy, and expansion.
Yeah. So it is so important that these battles are executed so well. We're talking about, look at the army supply here, for instance, for Nerchio. It's 175, guys.
Yeah, his army
is crazy.
It is bigger. Zest has a massive bank, and he can use a lot of it very quickly. So can the Zerg, though. So Zest's dropping a bunch of gateways right now just so he can transition if he needs to. If he absolutely needs desperation units on the ground, he can get it. But he really, really wants his air army to be huge here, and it's so far is quite still quite good, but Nerchio's setting up for a flank by the looks of things. Catching an observer is actually quite nice.
Note that one group of the infestors is not tagged, and that may be misleading to Zest. Zest may assume that that's all of the infestors, when in fact there's double that. And this could be kind of a funny setup that Zest has unintentionally put himself in, where he could end up getting tagged by Fungal.
Storm's going down there, doing a lot of damage on the Corruptors, actually. The Ultralis coming in for Cuddles on the ground, and they're going to hit the Archons and the High Templar. Feedback's going down, a huge Neural Parasite for Nerchio. Does he have enough to finish this army off? He decides this is the time, right here, right now, to get it done.
It looks like he might be able to do it. Practically everything has been Neural Parasited. He's going ham on his own units here. Stalkers do come in to try to drive back the Infestors.
And it's such a close, scrappy battle here. The Neural Parasite unit's doing a lot of damage to his own army, but Zest's army is still alive. The Brutalists need to retreat here for Nerchio, and the army supply is shooting ahead for the Polish Zerg. Zest using those six targets to come down, but that was a huge scrap. Both players lost a lot of resources.
If Todd was in this game right now, he would be saying, look at the supply, because we see 184 to 137 here. So Zest has remustered that army brilliantly, and notice he switched into different units now, sending these Zealots in here. This, I think, could be a mistake if the Broodlords can get down here in time, but he needs to try to deny that expansion at the bottom.
Zest can actually afford to throw these away, whereas Nerchio can't. He only has 200 minerals in the bank, Tasteless. There's not a whole lot as far as economy goes for the Polish Zerg here. He's losing these investors. I think that Nerchio actually cannot lose anything anymore. It's very, very important for him to make a very, very good trade or two here to stay alive.
And Zest is not stopping. He's maxed out again over here, so that army should be pushing in. This is a slow, technical, clunky army here for Nerchio. And what Zest did back there was switch back into the most basic quick tech that was cost efficient to come down there. Now, he did not deny the hatchery. It is still mineral rich.
But the work account, Tasteless, the income for Nerchio is not good at all. He's only at 500 minerals versus the 2,000 of Zest. Yes, Zest must be getting close to mine out, but he has still this incredible bank. He could put his kids through college with this bank here. He's got a very, very healthy mineral and gas bank, which is really, really critical. And you know, I mean, if he was a Terran, he was making units one at a time, it'll be a little bit rough, but he can actually warp in a bunch of things at once.
He has reset up a very sophisticated army here. He's got the Void Rays, he's got the Archons, he's got the Tempest, but can he push in?
Remember, he absolutely can, even though
he's maxed out right now, an overextension here would be huge. I would like to do a mineral check, but I don't think we have time right now here, as this push may be the climax of this game.
I think so, and I mean, Nerchio needs to have a really amazing fight here to stay alive, because this army of Zests is now better than his. And it's very, very tough to engage.
Can we do a mineral check real fast while we have time at the Protoss's base? Okay, not bad. Okay, that's basically gone. Pretty much gone.
You're giving him an out of 10?
Okay, so Zest is rapidly getting close to mining out here.
Yeah.
And Nerchio, as long as he stays around, and trust me, the spore defense here is super annoying with the Corruptors and everything else for the Protoss. If Nerchio can stay alive, but right now, advantage does go to Zest, as if he can actually stamp out that bottom base. That's this entire game story right now.
Yeah, a big kill like that would certainly spell destruction for the Zerg player. But, you know, another big Neural Parasite fight here. If he manages to get the critical units in and control them well, and manages to clear out the Protoss army without losing too much, he can stay alive for sure, but it's going to be very, very tough. It is a mountain to climb here for sure. He's trying to, I mean, he's been droning a little bit here and there to try and get his work count up. It is still not so great, but his army is very, very good, but he just has to be very patient. Zest, unfortunately for Nerchio, is being very patient as well.
Yeah, well, keep in mind, you know, with fungals, neural parasites, things like that, you can kill units practically for free for Zerg. It's an incredible way to eliminate stuff versus having two armies clash into each other. He's actually now, he's going to send in a few probes here, trying to get rid of this. Probes now going on to these spores here. And it looks like he's going to try to come in here for a dive.
And there's those neuroparasites going down. The investors are still alive. A huge neuroparasite from the top as well.
Oh, my God!
I think this actually means that most of Zest's army is actually under Nerchio's control, and he's starting to DPS it down, but does he have enough damage to finish him off? This big warp in of Zest could be very critical for him here.
The Stalkers are trying to push through. The Mothership Core still remains. The Broodlords, are they overextending? They begin to back up under the cover of the Spores. A few Lurkers here to try to defend, but the Stalkers can go around it.
Fungal going down the Stalkers, but he does lose the Broodlord in the end. And Nerchio giving up the hatchery. He can't defend it anymore. This is his only mining base, really, as the probes of Zest come up the forward as well, because they don't really have anything to mine from. Zest pressing the issue. This hatchery is going to go down. And there's that army supply shooting up. He has double the army supply of Nerchio now. And things going from bad to worse for him.
I think that may be the game-ending move. Good call there by getting the Stalkers as well. Something that can blink in there, do damage very quickly, and get back out if he needs to. And with that base no longer under the ownership of Nerchio, I believe he may be pretty much out of options.
Yeah, he's definitely starting to clutch at straws here as far as options go in this game. We're heading into the 35-minute mark, which is so rare for Legacy of the Void games.
Yeah, but no kidding.
You know, it's a treat to see a game of these two players being so closely matched from different sides of the world. We have this big Chargelot army, which is actually very scary for Nerchio, by the way. Primarily, his army is Infestors and Lings. And Chargelots, with all their upgrades, are very, very scary against all of that.
Okay. Once again, all Nerchio can do is try to get that base. But Zest has now decided he's going to start dismantling any Zerg territory on the map. Of course, you do have to destroy each other's buildings to win a StarCraft II game. It's not normally what it comes down to, because we know that's going to happen ahead of time. That was so good.
That's actually really, really nice,
yeah,
because these Infestors are borrowed. He needs to be able to spring the attack on Zest. But I don't even know if a big Neuroparasite attack can seal the deal here, I'll be honest. There is so much for the Protoss army here.
Look at the Protoss' army, if we can get a shot of it. There's not that much that you want a Neuroparasite there. I mean, it's a lot of Zealots and Stalkers and an Archon. It's not, when you see Void Rays and Tempests and stuff like that, that's when it can be handy to Neuroparasite, but Nerchio may have had to tech up to these Infestors to stop that complex Protoss army, and now he doesn't have the tools to deal with a simple one.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I mean, he's going to Neuroparasite the Mothership, certainly, maybe the Tempest as well, because he needs to get rid of that detection, the cloaking to make things easier for his units to hit the Protoss army. And the Tempest would be nice because they do the bonuses, and also the Void Rays are nice to grab as well, but yes. Neuroparasiting these Stalkers is going to be, I think, a waste of energy. He'd rather Fungal and Infested Terran than for sure.
Okay, beginning to edge here. It looks like he might try to just go in here and take out the tech. And we see Nerchio scrambling down here. I think Zest might give him that base and then just destroy the tech. Or Zest might try to set this up as a trap so that now the Zerg has to engage. And it looks like it's going to be just that.
So Nerchio is back against the wall here, using his Infestors to try and trade as efficiently as possible, but the Protoss army is just too strong, and he pushes all the way through, and there is just moments left in this game, Tasteless. This is the last stand for Nerchio.
He's coming through here now. That's going to be it. GG! Zest wins that series in an impressive 2-1, and what a special game that was back there. You know, I cast so much StarCraft 2, and rarely do I get to see a game where we finally get that far down the Protoss versus Zerg rabbit hole.
Absolutely. Now, this is just the start of the group. Neither player in danger of being eliminated just yet, but a nice advantage for Zest to get that series. And really brilliant games. This is high-level StarCraft at its best here at the Intel Extreme Masters in Katowice. And we cannot forget that Nerchio has been he's been on the finals stage in Spodek Arena, but Zest has won on that stage back in 2015, a long time ago. But we are going to take a short break, and then when we return, we're going to have the winners interviewed with Smix on stage, and then go to the guys at desk, and more games to follow. Do not go away.